Happy anniversary. Great is thy faithfulness, and welcome into the Lord's house this morning as we gather for worship. Great to see you today as we celebrate our 20th anniversary and thank God for all the blessings that he has bestowed upon us. If you are a guest or visitor, we welcome you in Christ's name. Nice to have you joining with us as we worship together. We will be following the printed order of worship as you have it there in front of you. Please note our opening hymn, Lift High the Cross, is on your yellow insert. You can see there on the left-hand side who's going to be singing each verse, and we will follow along with that. Our hymn of praise is also printed in your worship folder. The hymns that we will be singing out of the hymnal are on the hymn board and also listed in your order of service. Our opening hymn then is Lift High the Cross, and we will stand on the last verse.
Thank you.
Almighty God, as we gather to celebrate the anniversary of this congregation, we confess that we have failed to live as your people. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and we come to you seeking your forgiveness. We confess that we have too often built our lives on our own selfish desires and not on your holy will and word. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Forgive us, Lord, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. In his mercy, Almighty God sent his one and only Son to suffer and die on the cross to take the punishment for our sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We will join together in the prayer of the day. We pray. Gracious God, we bless you for this milestone in the life of our congregation. 20 years of word and sacrament ministry. We thank you for the dedication and devotion of members and friends, past and present, who labored in your name. By the Holy Spirit's presence and power, we commit ourselves to continue working together to your glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, amen.
Thank you. Today's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23, verses 1 through 6. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who care for my people. You have scattered my flock and have driven them away and have not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for your evil deeds, declares the Lord. Then I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will set shepherds over them who will care for them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed. Neither shall any be missing, declares the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell securely. And this is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is in Ephesians, the second chapter, verses 11 through 22. We will read together the epistle lesson as printed on page 3. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the Holy Gospel. Gospel this morning for our anniversary worship service, John 10, 11 to 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. This is the word of the Lord. Our confession of faith this morning will be Luther's Small Catechism, questions 173, 176, 179. Why is the church called Christian?
It belongs to Christ and is built on the law.
Why does Scripture call local congregations church? What do the Scriptures teach about our life in the church?
They teach that we should seek always to be and remain members of the visible church, Christ's body, by sincere faith in Christ our Savior. We should be faithful to that visible church or denomination which professes and teaches all of the Bible's doctrine purely and administers the sacraments according to Christ's institution. We should avoid false teachers, false churches, and all organizations that promote a religion that is contrary to God's word. We should maintain and extend God's church by telling others about Jesus Christ, by personal service, and by prayer and financial support. Please be seated.
Is found recorded for us in the 6th chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark,
beginning at the 30th verse. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught, and he said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away to the boat to a desolate place by themselves. Now many were going and recognized them, and they ran there by foot to all the towns and got there ahead of them. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when it grew late, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a desolate place, and the hour is now late. Send them away to go into the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered them, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat?" And he said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." When they had found out, they said, "Five and two fish." Then he commanded them all to sit down in groups on the green grass, as they sat down in groups by hundreds and by fifties. And taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. And he divided the two fish among them all. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and of the fish. And those who ate the loaves were 5,000 men. This is the word of the Lord. These are thy words, O God, help us and sanctify us in the truth. Thy word is truth. Amen. The Lord is expert in providing where human need must be met. Now, I'm a city boy, but I know enough to realize that the Creator has set into motion an abundance for the sustenance of man, just naturally, let alone by a miracle if necessary. Our text is dealing with a verifiable miracle witnessed by over 5,000 people. There's no simple one-to-one correspondence when it comes to food production. See, one kernel of wheat produces a stalk that yields 50 times more, 15,000 kernels per pound. That's 1 1/4 loaves of bread. There you've got 30 slices for 30 people. One kernel of seed corn produces a stalk that can grow several 7-inch cobs consisting of around 600 kernels each. 1,200, 1,800 kernels per stalk. That's a 1,200 to 1,800% increase. 90,000 kernels per bushel. That's enough servings for 150 people. That's abundant. An average U.S. dairy cow can produce 7.5 gallons of milk per day, about 21,945 pounds of milk a year, enough daily servings for 40 people. One grape seed can give way to a grapevine, and a single vine growing in a valley can produce 7.5 pounds of grapes per season. It takes 2.5 pounds of grapes to produce a bottle of wine. That makes 3 bottles per vine, 6 servings per bottle, and that's enough wine for 18 people. A calf is born, depending on its breed, at between 60 and 90 pounds. And a 1,200-pound steer will yield about 430 pounds of edible beef. That's good for the banquet table. A quarter pounder apiece will feed 1,720 people. That's God's abundance principle kicking in to keep us alive and happy. Spiritually, we are of a mustard seed faith or less, and yet the promise is that such faith will move mountains. By the confession of this faith, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the Lord's church. So the Lord sends forth his word and sacraments through faulty and frail preachers, and souls are added daily to the number of those who are being saved. 120 in Jerusalem on Pentecost, grew to 3,000 more on that very same day, and now there are presently over 1 billion living, breathing adherents claiming to be Christian. And those already within the church see a climbing confidence in the Lord based on his promises and our proclamation of them, so that fear subsides. Our focus becomes ever more divinely directed. Our salvation is clearly accomplished, providing a peace that passes understanding, and our hope of heaven is more certain from our own heart's point of view. Nothing could be more certain from the Lord's outlook, as he said that no one is able to pluck them or us out of his hand. Over the years, the Lord has sustained this congregation with nothing less than the gospel, the body and blood of Jesus, the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, a gracious word of pardon by Jesus' sacrifice that assures us that it is finished. All this redounds to the glory of our gracious and merciful Heavenly Father. So yes, he who boasts, let him boast in the Lord. What built this church that wasn't given from above? It was not our word, it was his word. A word about Jesus that began, continued, and will bring to completion this enterprise known as Good Shepherd Congregation. We did not and cannot earn our salvation. It is a gift of God. Faith flows from the calling, gathering, enlightening, and sanctifying of the Spirit of truth. And someone planted, some other watered, and another yet cultivated. But it was, is, and always will be the only true and triune God who gives the increase. Yes, for the feeding of 5,000 men, perhaps as many as 15,000 or more when you include women and children, seated in those clusters of 50 or 100, there should have been at least 5 loaves and several more fish than 2 to be distributed within those smaller bunches in that desolate place. That would not account for any leftovers at all. But the sum and total resources available were some young lads, 5 loaves and 2 fish, and no more. And there's nowhere else to turn to get more. However, Jesus came to give life and to give it abundantly. He's not just birthing, growing, and feeding souls. Rather, he is concerned about the needs of the whole person. He is standing there in the flesh because it is our flesh that needs redeeming. That's his Father's plan. He's the one as God-man who can do it. He's not just concerned about the state of your soul, but also the state and deliverance of your flesh. He's not planning on just bringing your spirit into heaven for that final and forever feast, but he will raise you up, body and soul, unto everlasting life to enjoy the aged meats and fine wine offered at the foot of the tree of life. As part and parcel of his concern for you, he knows your sin, which cannot be hidden from him as it can be from your friends and neighbors or even your family. And he does not back off from any of it, but the fullness of your filth and your complete criminal record, he hefts onto his own shoulders to deal with it as none other can, to pay for it in full. Besides that, if it wasn't already enough, he summons you to make known to him all needs and anxieties, so that in the day of trouble, when you call on him, he will deliver you and you will glorify him. How do you know that that's so? He is the same shepherd who leads his flock to feed in green pastures and to rest beside still waters until you dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He is the same Lord who promised, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age, and I will never leave nor forsake you." Furthermore, his track record is impeccable. When you've got a crowd for company, it's neither polite nor proper to leave them to fend for themselves. Our Lord and God Jesus couldn't think of anything less than providing from his abundance that man might not die but live. The forgiveness of sins was fully earned for those standing condemned by the immutable law of God and its relentless condemnation and its horrific consequences, both in the short and long term. We deserve not only abandonment for our many iniquities committed many times each day, but each sin ought to bring disappointment and despair to our minds and trouble in this world for wrong-headed decisions made for the sake of some fleeting pleasure here and now. We deserve not only that God would turn his back on us whom he created, and that which we ourselves broke and brought into corruption, but we deserve to be cast away from any good thing that the Lord would provide, thrown out of the garden and into the desolate wilderness. But the gospel is the great instead, also provided by a compassionate Lord. Instead of meager crumbs, he showers down manna. And when that isn't enough, he sends meat. Instead of hell, he opened up heaven to all who trust in him. Instead of bearing the death sentence, Jesus swallows whole death, grave, and hell, and comes out no worse for the wear, totally victorious, and sending us out to declare that his victory is ours. His crucifixion is death to our death, and his resurrection is life now and forever for us. Our eyes have been directed downward because that seemed our destiny. It seemed that life had no winning prospects for our future. We were headed to hell in a handbasket, bent even against our will, it would seem, for our own destruction, ready to exchange our inheritance for a pitiful pot of stew if we would meet our needs for now. But instead, in our spirit-led and motivated return to the Father's house, we have a signet ring for our fingers, shoes for our feet, a fine robe to cover our meager and wretched rags, and the fatted calf for a celebration of our return and resurrection. That is not our doing, but it is the Lord's love and God's own generosity that we do not get what is our due, but instead get what God graciously is giving. And this is marvelous in our eyes. A snack in the wilderness that we would not fall faint or die on our pilgrimage. A word from the Lord and we are full, satisfied in both body and soul, an act of grace and goodwill, not only for our survival, but for our eternal salvation. This is what the compassion of our Savior and his Father and Spirit are all about. We are beneficiaries of a bountiful bequest. Our celebration is surrounded by gracious words and divine deeds to remind us that to him, not to us, but to his name goes the glory. A true balance in the physical and the spiritual, the worldly and the heavenly, our need and Jesus' concern and action underscores that he became incarnate and was born for us. He lived his life for us. He took on our sin and its consequences so that we might be healed by his stripes and made whole by his wounds, reconciled to the Father by the sinless one, willingly becoming sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in and through him. He opened heaven and paradise for us. He rent asunder the grave and ripped us from death's icy grip so that neither can claim final authority over us. Sure, to hungry people gave them enough to perhaps tend to their needs for that time. But he intends to give us much more as we open up our beggar's sack and he pours into what was empty until it is overflowing with heavenly benefits and riches which neither can decay nor be depleted or of which we will never be deprived so long as we rest in his presence and seek from him every good and perfect gift. Good Shepherd congregation and all God's people who come here to be revitalized in God's grace through Christ Jesus exists because God has been good and not because we are in any way sufficient in and of ourselves. The congregation's past, present, and future, as is true of Christianity throughout the world, must rest in the gospel and the goodness of God revealed through the words and works of His Son. He is truly the Lord of the feast, both regarding this festival, celebrating the years God has been good to these people in this place, but He is the Lord of the feast in that His intentions are that you would, by faith, abide with Him in this life and then face to face, join Him at the banquet that knows no end. He has begun all of this, and He can and will bring it to completion, and you will be full and you will be satisfied, and there will be leftovers, and He will receive all the glory. In any celebration, it's good, right, and proper to toast to the one who has provided what we enjoy. What has He not given? What has been left out and is lacking? As St. Paul said to the Corinthian congregation in his first epistle, and it holds true for Good Shepherd Lutheran Church as well, in every way you were enriched so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift. So, glory, honor, power, and praise to the Lord of the feast. Amen. And now may the grace of God and His peace be and abide with you now and forever for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please rise for the prayer of the church. Our prayers for this morning are printed out for us on pages 5 and 6. Dear loving Heavenly Father, your loving kindness toward us is especially evident today. We thank and praise you for creating your church and for giving life to this congregation through the power of your Holy Spirit. Hear now our petitions for Jesus' sake as we come to you as your people. For the children of our church, that they would continue to be nurtured in your word, both by their teachers at Good Shepherd, and most importantly, by their parents. Give them the strength to overcome the world and remain faithful throughout their lives. Lord, in your mercy. For the young adults of our church, whether in college, the military, or the workplace, give them the promise of your presence, your love and forgiveness, that they might be faithful to you. Lord, in your mercy. For those in our congregation who have lapsed in their commitment to be in worship and therefore strengthened by word and sacrament, help them through the Holy Spirit to see this is the most important hour of their week, and use all of us to encourage them to make the appointed time in God's house. Lord, in your mercy. Good Shepherd, in her short history, has always been a caring church family. We lift up today those in our congregation who are sick, hospitalized, homebound, attacked by dark forces, or suffering in any way. Sustain them by your strength and protection. Give hope and healing, comfort and faith as they seek help from you, Lord God. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. May we walk together in faith and never lose the reliance in your word as the only source of how this is accomplished. Keep us as members informed through our leaders. And though we don't know the future, we do know that you, Heavenly Father, will lead that future. Lord, in your mercy. We praise you, Lord, for the pastors and teachers who have served Good Shepherd. Keep them faithful in their calling, and may this church continue to be a positive role model where staff members work together in love to further the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. 20 years is just a beginning for Good Shepherd. We have so much work to do. Faith has brought us this far, and faith will carry us on. Work in us faithfulness to the gospel, and then allow us to share that message that is so needed for this generation. Christ, our Lord and Savior, has been good to us. Thanks be to God as we place these prayers in your loving arms.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let us pray. Having nourished us with the body and blood of Jesus, O Lord, we ask that you would send us into the world in peace. Give us courage to proclaim your love, compassion for all who are in need, wisdom to discern right from wrong, and peace in our heart which comes from confidence in your love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Once again, and thank you to everybody participating in today's worship service. It was great. Thank you, President Miller, for being with us this whole weekend, and pray the Lord's blessings be upon you now that you've been re-elected as our district president. Have Pastor Miller come out. You can shake his hands as you leave down the middle of the congregation this morning. I wanted to just point out, if you weren't able to be at our celebration last night, we did receive from our representative, State Representative Dan Brady, this from the state of Illinois. It acknowledges Good Shepherd Lutheran Church, the 20th anniversary of the chapter of your congregation, and with appreciation for your demonstrations of faithfulness and dedication to the Lord's message. With further best wishes for continued success, and it's offered by Representative Dan Brady. So we will get that hung up here in our church, and we are thankful for that. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The only other announcement that I have, other than what is listed in the bulletin, as part of the 20th anniversary celebration last night, we were having a cupcake and a prayer shawl fundraiser. There are some left downstairs in the Bible study, so if you're down there, those will be out for free will donation, and any funds collected will be going for the repair of the organ. So make sure you check those out if you're downstairs as part of the Bible study. Anything else? Any other announcements anybody may have? That being heard, we
go with God this week.